I'm you through the white Kia Seltos HTK+. Now, yes, you are right. You might have already seen my review of the steel silver HTK+ Kia Seltos petrol variant. That is the exact same vehicle over there. But why am I reviewing again the HTK+ again? Because this here is the diesel variant, and there is one big difference between the diesel HTK+ and the petrol. You can see that the diesel variants get all-wheel disc brakes as standard from the entry-level variant itself. So I don't know the reason behind why does Kia offer disc brakes only on diesel variants, but it is fine. Could be because of the cost and the difference. So yeah, as you can see in white, this car seriously looks nice. It has that typical elegant look to it, even though it does not have a lot of chrome detailing on the outside. Well, the rest of the car looks exactly the same. It's got exactly the same features as on the petrol variants, except for the rear disc brakes. So yeah, that's all on the outside. You can watch my detailed review of the HTK+ petrol in the link in the description box below. So let's just hop on into the engine bay. So right now I'm opening the hood of this diesel HTK+ variant. So under the bonnet, under the heavy bonnet to be precise, just open it. Yeah, so that is the CRDI 16 volt 4 cylinder 1.5 liter turbocharged diesel engine, which produces about 115 horsepower and a torque of 250 newton meters through a 6-speed manual transmission. So yeah, that is it on this vehicle. So what do you think about this white color Kia Seltos? Being India, white and silver are the most selling colors. So I guess we will be getting to see these colors on road more often. So, and I am here to show you through all the differences and features of the HTK+ variant against the X+ variants, which we had already reviewed. The first thing you may notice is that this car looks much more subtle without all the chrome finishing and the fancy stuff. You can notice that the Tiger nose grille remains the same, but the chrome has been replaced by a 4 aluminium brushed metal finish with the knurled finishing on them. The next thing you may notice is that the headlamps, the standard all LED packaging has been replaced by regular bulbs and a projector unit for the headlamps. You can see that the indicators are now regular bulbs. While the headlamps being projectors, even the fog lamps have been replaced by projector units instead of standard LED. This makes the car look much more subtle and pinned down against the flashy and all fancy top-end X+ variants. Now coming on over to the side, you may notice that the wheel size has also been reduced. These are 16-inch alloy wheels with 205/65 size tires. So this is kind of a standard size for a compact SUV, but for a premium SUV, this looks kind of too subtle. The design also is a bit too subtle. Coming to the braking, you can see that the front wheels get disc brakes, whereas the back get drums only for the petrol variants. Why am I saying that only petrol variants get drum at the back? Because the diesel variants get all four discs from the entry-level variants itself. So this here is a look at the side profile. All the chrome finishing has been replaced by black, and this looks much more subtle. Well, the roof rails also remain the same in terms of design, even the material finishing on that differs. Coming on over to the rear, you can see that even the all LED tail lamps have been replaced by part LED and part regular bulbs. You can see that the braking lights are now regular bulbs instead of LED units. So, but the standard things, the good things remain the same. You get standard reverse parking camera, reverse parking sensors, and rear wiper and defogger from this variant itself, which is a really good thing and hard to see in certain new cars. So yeah, you can see that the rear profile remains the same except for the faux exhaust finishing. The good thing is that the actual exhaust is hidden away, pretty neatly tucked away, which is really good job from Kia Motors. You can see that it's standard with rear defogger and rear wash wipe function also. Well, that is all about the Kia Seltos HD K Plus on the outside. It looks subtle. It looks fine. It looks premium on the top end model, but it does not look imposing and full of presence, which is a standard character for an SUV. This looks more like an urban crossover against an SUV, but it still looks seriously good. Right now, I am inside the Kia Seltos HD K Plus. And as you can see, largely the layout remains the same, except for certain features and the equipment list. First of all, the steering wheel remains the same, except for the leather wrap. Even though this feels like a quality unit, it lacks the leather feel and it works, it's okay. Nothing apart from that. On the doors, as you can see, everything remains the same. All the controls are the same. They work the same. They are same good quality units. Even the door handle and all the trims look the same exactly, except for the speakers. These are regular speakers from Archimedes instead of Bose. Only the top end GT X Plus and the HT X Plus get the Bose system. I don't know how much speakers do you get on this. Could be 6 or could be 4. But they are supposed to sound just okay. Definitely not up to Bose levels. And one thing I seriously miss on the door pads is that there is no kind of soft touch finish as on the top end variants. These are just hard plastics. No soft touch materials, nothing on the door pads on this variant. I don't know if the HTX variant gets soft touch materials, but this is the HT K Plus for now. And no ESP, no traction control, no other features. You get simply the headlamp leveler and interior lighting controls. You get the push button start though, which is a good thing. Given that this is the mid-level variant, that's a good feature. And you even get cruise control, which is also a really helpful feature. The door pads are of similar size. They can hold good size 1-liter bottles. But this is the difference over here. This is the touchscreen system. It's an 8-inch unit. And it does not come with the UO connect connectivity features of the top end variants. This gets reverse camera, of course, and certain other regular standard features, including Bluetooth, USB, AUX, and everything. I'll just show you the ports again. This is the 12 volt charging socket. This is the USB, and this is the USB smart charger. So that's all for that. But there is one big miss. Even though you get cruise control and reverse parking camera, and hell, even almost all the features you need except for automatic temperature control. These are just manual units, so you don't get much functionality. This is just standard, but even though they are manual, the levers and the switch gear are of really good quality. Surprisingly, I would say kind of like Volkswagen quality, so that's really good. Well, standard, you get only two buttons. The rest three are just turning knobs, and there is one rear defogger button over here. So that's all for the AC unit. And lower down, you can see that no beige or no lighter materials. All over the interior, you can see that it's an all black and gray cabin. It's a black and gray theme. This material on the top end model was leather, whereas on this variant, you get a plastic textured panel. It feels good. It does not feel cheap, but it is plastic. It is unavoidably plastic. And yeah, of course, you get dual airbags as standard. You get ABS. You get front disc brakes on this variant. And apart from that, on this interior, you can see that the overall interior looks really plush, even for this mid variant. It really looks plush, and it's got all the fancy stuff and all the chrome and silver finishing and all. But this gear lever seriously looks like out of
an entry-level Hyundai Creta. So this gear lever looks out of place in this cabin, that's what I would say. The instrument cluster looks standard, like it reminds you of the Hyundai Venue's entry-level variants. It gets a color display, but it's small, it's not that large. You can see that it shows which door is open exactly. The boot is open currently, so yeah, it just functions well. I can't switch it on because the key is unavailable. So apart from that, you get a center armrest with a soft touch padding, so that is good, but it is not sliding. You get a decent storage space inside. It's not cooled though, and it's not slidable, it's just fixed in position. You get two cup holders here. You get a standard size glove box. I don't think this is a cooled glove box, but it just works fine. So rest of the interior, as you can see, remains exactly the same except for the UVO connect. As you can see, the IRVM does not get any UVO connect or auto dimming feature. It's just a manual switch for the day and night functions. You get the standard sunglass holder. You get the very standard and cheap looking yellow lights for a premium car. Yellow lights, I don't know how that works. And you get the standard ticket holder on the driver's side visor. A vanity mirror for the passenger side. And this roof lining material is actually looking like, I don't know, jute. Well, it is definitely cloth, but it is not as soft as a fabric. It looks kind of a jute material or recycled material, so it's kind of weird, but I don't think many people will notice that. And you get standard grab handles for interior passengers, but they are not retractable. They are just standing there. They are not foldable, not retractable. Kind of an entry level design. You get a speaker panel for the center, but I don't know if there's a speaker over there on the dashboard. So talking about the system, I am unable to operate it, but the display looks large. It's right in the eye line, sight of view for the driver, so that's really helpful. But it is kind of further to reach while you are driving. Like if you are driving with the hands on a steering wheel, I mean, you can reach it, but it's kind of further away. So that's a good thing that you get manual controls for the audio system as well. You get even controls on the steering wheel itself, so that's a really good thing. So talking about the driver's seat, it is manually adjustable only on this variant. So as you can see, this is the height adjust, this is the recline function, but the quality of the lever seems just about okay, not even up to Hyundai Creta levels, that is what I feel, but it works fine. It's got the decent heft. This is the fuel cap opening lever, and this here is the bonnet opening lever. So I'll just open the bonnet for you now. Additionally, you have this panel where you can access the fuse box, I suppose. So on the top end model, you have seen that the pedals get aluminium finish, but on this model, it's just standard V pattern black pedals. You get a dead pedal also. Wow, that is a heavy bonnet. This is the 1.5 liter 4-cylinder petrol engine. It is naturally aspirated, not the turbocharged one as on the GT X Plus variant which we saw lastly. So getting inside the back seat, so you can see that the driver's seat has been adjusted for my height, and I have got decent amount of space just like on the top end variants, but you don't get any seat back pockets for the rear seat passengers. That's kind of weird, not even on the passenger side. Well, apart from that, you get rear aircon vents, which is really good, but given that it's not an automatic temperature control unit, it's only manual, I don't know how effective would it be. It would be as effective as a Hyundai Venue or a Hyundai Creta, that's what I suppose. You don't get any kind of charging socket for the rear passengers. You get just this small storage pocket. And good thing is that even on this variant, you get sun blinds. You get manually retractable sun blinds for the rear seats, which is actually really good. They are of good quality. Well, exactly the same as on the top end models. Apart from that, this is a livable cabin. And yeah, you don't get a rear center armrest, which for a premium car is not a good sight, but I think that this is the key for better aggressive pricing. And you don't even get adjustable headrests for the back passengers. So I think that this variant could be priced seriously aggressive, given that it's lacking quite a few features. Like, it's kind of weird when you see that this has got cruise control but does not get automatic AC and even rear headrests and armrests for the passengers. So apart from that, this variant seems fine. You get all the essential features you may need as a family member and a family person. This here is another good look at the HTK Plus dashboard. It is a good looking dashboard. Everything feels good in quality, except for the gear lever. It looks seriously cheap. Like, it looks an entry level Creta or even a Grand Titan's gear lever. So yeah, that's all about the interior. I'll just check out the boot space right now. So let's go. So you get a request sensor button for the boot opening as well. So this here is a request sensor. And opening the boot, you can see that even this variant gets tag hooks to hang the parcel shelf. So that is actually a good thing. The boot space remains the same, exactly standard, but you don't get rear seat split function. On the top end model, it had a 60-40 split, but this model gets a single fold mechanism only. You get a standard boot lamp. You get the spare wheel. If you might have noticed on my previous Seltos video, the GTX Plus and even the HTX Plus did not get a full size spare wheel. They got spare wheels which were a size lower, but on this variant it's 16 inch, which is in norms with the standard wheel size of this car. Given that this car gets all 16 inch wheels on this HTK Plus variant, but on the top end models, the HTX Plus and the GTX Plus, even though the alloys were 17 inch, the spare tire was 16. Another thing I forgot to mention was that this variant also gets automatic headlamps and automatic wipers, which is kind of weird, I suppose, because this variant does not get rear adjustable headrests itself, but you get push button start, you get a massive touchscreen, you get automatic headlamps and wipers, so, and cruise control, of course. So that is it on this HTK Plus variant. I am expecting the prices for this petrol HTK Plus variant to be around 13 lakhs on road. So do let me know what do you think about this variant. And yeah, it's a decently equipped car, so I suppose this variant will be a good seller. So thanks for watching. This is Viprajesh signing off.
Watching this video, please subscribe for more videos. If you like this video, click the like buttons and give your comments.